Good afternoon. Today I'm going to practical on viral test and rapid plasma reagent test. Before going to test, we should know what is this viral test and rapid plasma reagent test. First, I'm going to explain about the viral test. This Salmonella organism can be bacteriological. So bacteriological diagnosis of this salmonellosis can be done by isolation of the bacteria and demonstration of the antibodies. If you see this bacteremia, bacteremia means the presence of bacteria in the blood that to be salmonella. Presence bacteremia of this salmonella is usually seen in early stage of the disease, that is during the first week and second week and third week. At that time, isolation of this salmonella bacteria is almost 90%. Is almost in the first week it is almost 90% can be isolated from the blood, and then onwards from second week to third week from blood culture bacilli can be isolation it is approximately 75%, and in the third week it is approximately 60% in case of specimen of blood. Next one is Salmonella bacteria can also be isolated from the urine, but these are usually isolated during the period of second week and third week. Okay, second week and third week. And next comes the viral test. Viral test is nothing but it's a serological diagnostic test. Rising tide of antigens usually appear after the agglutinins, not antigens. Agglutinins are nothing but the antibodies. These antibodies are seen usually seen after the first week of the infection of the salmonella. Okay, so after 1 week only this viral test should be done. This viral test is mainly used to demonstrate the presence of the antibodies. But this viral test should not be used during the first week of the infection. The patient may be presented with fever. Okay. At that time, during the first week of the fever, it doesn't give any good result. It is used only after the first week of the infection only, because agglutinins will going to appear after the first week of the infection. Okay. During the second period, agglutinins is going to rise from second week to fourth week. The positivity rate in the second week of the viral test is a little bit it is going to rise slowly. So at low titers we can see the agglutination. In the third week we can observe the 80 to 100%, and fourth week also somewhat we'll see. After that, there's a gradual decline of the titer of the antibodies. Gradual decline in the rising the titer of the antibodies. So this viral test should be asked only after 1 week of the infection. This 1 week, the person can present with the clinical manifestations like fever, headache, malaise. Stepladder. The fever should be, is in case of enteric fever, it is presented as stepladder. And other clinical manifestation of the enteric fever is the person may have the person may present with bradycardia. Okay, next. next after fourth week this there is a gradual decline in the rising titer of the antibodies we'll observe. Okay, next next comes the other specimen, that is feces. The feces culture, I mean this bacteria will bacteria can be isolated. This salmonella bacteria can be isolated from the feces also. It is almost equivalent to isolation is equal almost equivalent to the blood culture. It is present. This bacteria is present throughout the throughout the illness. This bacteria may also be isolated from the carriers or also some also from the patients. And at the and another important thing is this another important thing is the persons who are taking drugs can also who are taking drugs can also this specimen can also be used to this specimen as a specimen acts as a good good for culturing of the bacteria, whereas because most of the drugs will most of the drugs will lyse the bacteria from in the blood but doesn't kill the bacteria in the feces in the gut. So that's why the persons who are taking drugs also feces can be used as a good specimen for culturing of the salmonella. Okay, this is about the specimen collection based on different phases of the enteric fever. Next, what's the principle of this viral test? Viral test is mainly used for the measurement of the antibodies, that to be against the salmonella type B and para type A and B. Here the principle is viral test is an agglutination test. It is an agglutination test in which specific typhoid fever antibodies, specific typhoid antibodies are detected by mixing the patient's serum with the killed bacterial suspension of salmonella, carrying specific O, H, AH and BH. O and AH belongs to the typhi, okay, salmonella typhi, antigens, and observed for clumping. Nowadays we have commercially available kits. So from commercially available kits are there for enteric fever. What are they? We'll see. So this what are the requirements for viral test? Here these are some of the things that are necessary to perform the viral test. First one is Dreyer's agglutination tube. What is this Dreyer's agglutination tube? This tube is a narrow tube. It's a narrow tube with the conical bottom. Sharp ga untadannamata, conical ga untadannamata. So as to observe the H agglutination. So Dreyer's agglutination tube is mainly used for demonstration of the H antibodies. And next one is Felix agglutination tube. This Felix agglutination tube shape is like very, it is a little bit short one compared to the Dreyer's tube. Short and round bottom tube. Here it is, Dreyer's tube contains a conical bottom and narrow tube. Here this one is short and round bottom tube for to demonstrate the O antibody agglutination. So these two tubes are mainly used. What are the things that are present in the kit? Here and this is the kit. This is the kit for viral test. I mean commercially available kit. This kit contains S type means salmonella type. salmonella type E O antigen. Here we are going to demonstrate the antibodies from the patient serum, but our kit contains O antigen, H antigen, type E H antigen, paratype E A for salmonella paratype E A, AH antigen for salmonella paratype B, BH antigen. And again, besides this, this kit also contains viral positive control and negative control, so as to check the autoagglutination. So as to check the autoagglutination of the antigens. With the help of these positive control, negative control, we can check the antigen proper functioning. And also it contains viral test card or slide, and also it contains applicator stick. Okay, not for this stick is not necessary for viral tube. It is necessary for rapid slide agglutination test. And most important requirement for viral test is patient serum. Okay, patient serum and normal saline. That normal saline to be isotonic saline, that is about 0.85%. Okay, these are the requirement for viral test. See, these are the antigens. Okay, this is positive control and negative control, red cap and green cap, and this one is AH antigen. This is some type here a little bit mistake, there is a mistake here. AH antigen, this is BH, this is AH, is wrongly written, but antigens are AH, BH, TO and TH, like that. The kits are labeled like that, like TO, TH, AH and BH. This is the slide. Okay, white glass slide contains circles. So what are the types of tests available in case of viral test? Here we have qualitative and quantitative. Qualitative is nothing but a rapid slide agglutination test. With the help of this rapid slide agglutination test, result can be obtained on the day itself only. Okay, and here in this case we can observe the agglutination, whereas in this case quantitative agglutination test, in this case we use the tubes. Okay, tubes are used for the measurement of the antibodies. Okay, tubes are used for measurement of the antibodies, but the result is obtained only on the next day. But here rapid slide agglutination can be seen on the day itself only. So this is just for knowledge, for your knowledge, for knowledge purpose only I'm telling. This is not necessary in your exams. Viral test is only necessary in your exams. Here, how this rapid slide agglutination test can be done. First, place a dropper. Just forget these all things. Just think this the circles contain the circles are empty. First, put a drop of the normal saline in each drop, in each circle. Put a drop of, put a drop of patient serum. Okay, put a drop of patient serum on each circle. This is TO, TH, AH, and BH. Patient serum. Put a drop of patient serum. And put a drop of negative control and positive control, which is available in the kit. Okay. To this, add a drop of corresponding antigen. Corresponding antigen that is present, that is available from the kit. That is TO. TO antigen. Put a drop of TO antigen. And put a drop of TH antigen, and put a drop of AH antigen, and put a drop of BH antigen. And to these controls, you may add O antigen or B antigen, whatever it may be. No, just to check the any autoagglutination. Okay, after placing, just spread the specimen with the help of the applicator sticker. Just mix the specimen with the antigen by using the applicator stick. After that, place and here. After that, place this slide on the mechanical rotator for 1 minute, and see for after 1 minute, see or observe the any agglutination present in the circles. Here it is visible. These two circles contains the agglutination. There is a clearing and clumping of the particles. Here there is no that much of, I mean, here there is no clumping. Here it's a clear agglutination are visible. So the patient is we can say the patient is suffering from typhi, Salmonella typhi. Here the antigens, I forgot to tell you one thing. Here we are not using the AVO antigen and BVO antigen. Here we are using only one O antigen, that is TVO antigen only we are using. Okay, because AVO antigen, TVO antigen, as they may cross react due to the presence of sharing factor 12. Here we are using only TVO antigen, so as to prevent the cross reaction between AVO, BVO, and TVO antigen, only single O antigen we are using. Here we are using because they are sharing with the factor 12. So here the positive control should be present. Should have agglutination. And negative control should not show any agglutination. This is a check for kit. Okay, controls are mainly used to check the test whether it is performed, performed by this kit is good or not. Control, because of that only we are using the controls. This is not in that much important, just for knowledge purpose only I told. Next one is viral test. You should know about this viral procedure and viral test principle, what are the requirements, and what are the interpretation points, where you will use this viral test is very important. Okay, you may get as an applied exercise as a spotter in your final exam. So if you see the procedure of this viral test, here we have to take a rack, iron rack, I mean some stainless steel rack, which contains holes. In these holes we'll put Reyes tube and Felix tube. Already told, Reyes tube is mainly used for H agglutination and Felix tube is mainly used for O agglutination. Here, this first row contains 8 tubes. Okay, 8 tubes. Oh, this row is corresponds to the O for O agglutination, for demonstration of the O agglutination. And this row will show the TH agglutination, and this row will show the AH agglutination. Extra row is there, I think. Only four rows should be present in the stainless steel rack. Okay, TO, TH, and this row corresponds to the for demonstration of the AH aggregation, and this is for we are demonstrating only A, B, but not C. Extra row is there here, and here we are demonstrating. Here this row corresponds to the demonstration of the BH aggregation. Okay, these are the rows with tubes, and this this is this column is first column, second column, third column, fourth column, fifth column, and sixth column. Sixth column, and this final column will have negative controls, so as to check the not negative controls. We can use this column as a control, so as to check the set and check the autoagglutination of the antigens. Okay. Okay. After that, here we arranged the tubes in the vidal rack. After that, in the first column, add 1.9 ml of isotonic saline or 0.85% saline. Okay, in the first column, add 1.9 ml of isotonic saline. I think that is 0.85%. Okay, and next. And next from next second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth columns, we had to add 1 ml of the 0.85% column, 0.85% saline. Here this first column contains 1.9 ml, and the second, third, fourth, fifth and sixth tubes contains 1 ml of saline. To the first column of the tubes, add 0.1 ml of the patient serum, which we want to demonstrate the antibodies against the enteric fever. Just add 0.1 ml of patient serum. Mix it thoroughly with the help of the pipette. Okay, with the help of the pipette, mix it thoroughly. After mixing, transfer. Here this contains 2 ml of the dilution of the serum. Okay, 2 ml of the dilution of the serum. These all tubes contains 1 ml of the saline only. Here this tube contains 2 ml of the saline, diluted serum. Transfer 1 ml of the diluted serum to the next tube. Okay, here it is shown here. Transfer 1 ml of the diluted serum to the next tube, second tube. Mix it thoroughly. And next, again, transfer 1 ml of the diluted serum into the third tube. Like that, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth tube. From here, take 1 ml of the diluted serum and discard it properly in a disinfectant solution. Should discard in a proper way. Otherwise, it may infect the persons who are working there. So it should be discarded in a disinfecting solution. It should be properly discarded. Now all the tubes contains. In all tubes, we should do like this only. Transfer 1 ml, 1 ml, 1 ml, 1 ml from second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, like that. and from the last tube it should be 1 ml is discarded in a proper way. So all the tubes can now at present all tubes contains how much ml, not in the last column, it should not in the last column, it is used only for the to check the controls, to check the auto agglutination, it should contain only saline only. From here only you should stop from here only. So this all tubes contains 1 ml of the diluted serum in the ratio of 1:20. I mean first tube, first column, 1:20, 1:40, 1:80, 1:160, and 1:320. If you arrange in the next next column, we'll have another another ratio, that is 1:640, like that. So they are in the ratio like that. After that, add corresponding antigen which is available from the kit, that is place a drop of O antigen in all these tubes. First row is corresponds to the O for demonstration of O agglutination. Because of that, add one drop of the O antigen in this row, and to this control also add one drop of the O antigen. Next, here you should add one drop of the TH antigen like that. For this row, add one drop of TH antigen for this control also, like that. AH antigen in all these tubes. And to this control also, like that, in all these tubes, place a drop of the BH antigen, and to this control also. We don't have any C antigen. We are using only TO, TH, AH, and BH only. Okay. After placing these antigens, mix properly. Cover it. Cover it with a foil and incubate at 37 degrees centigrade overnight in a water bath. It should not be left as it is. It should be incubated at 37 degrees centigrade in a water bath. Some scientists may recommend it should be incubated at 50 to 55 degrees centigrade for 2 hours. After that, they left at room temperature overnight. So these are the two procedures for incubation. And the next day, observe for agglutination and interpret the results. How we are going to interpret the results, we'll see. So this is the procedure I told. This is the rack, vinyl rack. These are the tubes. Blue colored solution contains O antigen and patient serum. And behind this tube, you are seeing one pink colored solution tube. These are TH antigen. All H antigens are pink in color, colored antigen. We are using colored antigens. O antigens are blue in color. TH, AH, BH are all pink in color. These are control tube. This is a control tube. In your exams, we will keep this rack for your applied access or as a spotter. So how you are going to interpret the result? So Felix tube is mainly used for demonstration of the O agglutination. How it appears? Agglutination is seen as a compact, a granular agglutination at the bottom of the tube. Granular deposit ga untadu anamata agglutination. అదే హెచ్ఎగ్లుటినేషన్ అయితే ఎలా ఉంటది, యాజ్ ఇట్ ఈస్ ఎ నారో ట్యూబ్ ఇస్ ఎ కోనికల్ బాటమ్, ఇట్ కంటైన్స్ ఎ లూస్ కాటన్ వూలీ క్లంప్స్. ఇదైతే గ్రాన్యులర్ గా ఉంటది, ఇదైతే కాటనీ వూలీ క్లంప్స్ గా ఉంటది అనమాట. ఇప్పటి ద పేషెంట్ సీరమ్ contains antibodies for H, can be seen as loose cotton woolly clumps. Okay, and saponin should be clear ga untad anamata. And how you are going to interpret? Interpretation is very important in case of this viral test. Here the agglutinins will going to appear appearance of the agglutination depend upon the stage of the disease. Okay, usually I already told this agglutinins will appear only after the first week of the fever, first week of the disease only we'll see the agglutinins. Agglutinins are nothing but the antibodies. If the test is done within 7 days of this fever, viral test will give a false negative result. So as to see a correct result, viral test should be investigated only after the first week of the fever or infection or disease, anything. Okay, after first week, in the second week, third week and fourth week, there is a rising titer of the antibodies. After that, there is a decline. If the test is investigated after fourth week of the disease, you may not get the correct result, because at that stage there is a decline of the agglutinins. Decline of the titer of the antibody. At the time it may give as a false negative result also. Next one is should be given very carefully, because in this case sometimes it may have high agglutination, sometimes it may have low agglutination. Should be given viral single viral test agglutination should be given very cautiously, basing on clinical stage and clinical manifestations, like enteric fever may present with stepladder fever, bradycardia and rose spots, like that. Basing on clinical manifestation also, the clinician may physician may correlate with the viral test investigation when it is done as a single test. Usually rising titer of the antibodies is very rising titer of the antibodies is significant. How we'll see this rising titer of the antibodies after doing the first viral test, ask the patient to come after the 10 to 14 days. If the person is suffering with enteric fever, the person may show 3 to 4-fold rise of the antibody titer. Okay, that is significant. But a single test is not significant. But should be in emergency, it can be given based on the clinical manifestations or some. It should be given very cautiously. Usually, it should be performed as a paired test. After first test, ask the patient to come after 10 to 14 days. Then only we'll see there is a rising titer of the antibodies, fourfold rising titer of the antibodies. What is this titer? This titer is nothing but dilution of the serial dilution of the antibody, which shows the highest dilution of the serum showing agglutination. Okay, titer is nothing but highest dilution of the serum showing agglutination is nothing but a titer. It is taken as a highest titer and should be given. It should be reported as a like that, 1 in 60, 1 in 80, like that. I will tell. And another important thing is interpretation is agglutinins may be present due to prior infection or due to prior infection or maybe due to immunization or maybe due to prior infection valla kavachu lekapothe immunization valla kuda kavachu. So see, presence of this agglutination in the viral test should not be taken as a take it as a positive result. It should be correlated. Sometimes the person may have individual may be immunized with tab vaccine. They may have the agglutinins of this typhoid paratype A and paratype B. By seeing the agglutinins, it should not be said that the person is suffering with enteric fever. Immunization చేయించుకున్నప్పుడు ఈ యాంటీబాడీస్ కూడా ఉండొచ్చు అన్నమాట. బట్ ఒకవేళ ఇఫ్ ద పర్సన్ ఇస్ రియలీ సఫరింగ్ విత్ ఎంట్రిక్ ఫీవర్ ద పర్సన్ మే హ్యావ్ ద అగ్లూటినిన్స్ అగ్నెస్ టు దట్ స్పెసిఫిక్ ఇన్ఫెక్టింగ్ ఆర్గనిజం. ఒకవేళ పారాటైపీ ఏతో ఉంటే కనుక ఆ అగ్లూటినిన్సే కనపడతాయి, లేకపోతే పారాటైపీ బితో సఫర్ అవుతుంటే ఆ అగ్లూటినిన్సే కనపడతాయి అన్నమాట. సో ఇఫ్ యు సీ ఆల్ అగ్లూటినిన్స్ అనుకోండి, అన్ని యాంటీబాడీస్ కనపడుతున్నా అంటే ద పర్సన్ మే హావ్ ఇమ్యునైజ్డ్ ట్యాబ్ వ్యాక్సిన్ అన్ని ఉంటాయి కాబట్టి మనం అది ఇమ్యునైజ్డ్ అని చెప్తాం అనమాట. ఒక అగ్లూటినిన్ ఒక టైప్ ఆఫ్ అగ్లూటినిన్ కనపడితే కనుక the person is suffering with either maybe paratypoid or typhoid. So and another thing is it should be differentiated with anamnestic reaction also. How it can be differentiated because of some unrelated fever also we'll observe the agglutinins. How this anamnestic reaction is differentiated? It is differentiated by doing the test after 1 week. In that case there is a transient in that case we can't observe any agglutinins. Before test shows that it has some transient rise. If the person is really suffering with this enteric fever, we'll see there is a rise. So this is paired test is very important. Where we can see the rising titer of the antibodies. What are the limitations of the test? It is a presumptive serological test for enteric fever, and in low typhoid endemic areas, weak and delayed O and H antibodies response limit the usefulness of the viral test. Viral test should be interpreted in the light of baseline titers in a healthy local population. These are the limitations of the test. Next test is RPR test. What is this RPR test? It's mainly used for syphilis. It's a screening test. It's not a confirmatory test. It is a screening test. Rapid plasma reagent test. దీనిలో ఒకవేళ నెగిటివ్ ఇఫ్ యు సీ ఎనీ నాన్ రియాక్టివిటీ బై దిస్ టెస్ట్ వి వాంట్ సే ద పర్సన్ డజంట్ హ్యావ్ ఎనీ సిఫిలిస్. సో ఇట్ ఈస్ ఓన్లీ అ స్క్రీనింగ్ టెస్ట్. ఇఫ్ ద పర్సన్ హ్యావ్ స్ట్రాంగ్ సస్పీషియస్ దే మే గో ఫర్ కన్ఫర్మేటరీ టెస్ట్ లైక్ టీఏపీహెచ్ అదర్ టెస్ట్ కన్ఫర్మేటరీ టెస్ట్ అదేనా. The person should be confirmed with other confirmatory tests of the syphilis. RPR test is only a screening test. What is this RPR test? This is a rapid plasma reagent test which can be seen by our with our eyes. Rapid test is a macroscopic non-trimethyl flocculation cord test that detect antibodies produced against antigens released by damaged host cells in patients suffering from syphilis. What are the requirements for RPR test? It requires RPR antigen. This RPR antigen Here, this is also RPR kit is also commercially available. This what this RPR antigen contains? This RPR antigen contains cardiolipin, lecithin, carbon particles, cholesterol. Cholesterol and choline chloride. Carbon particles, EDTA. These are the things that is present in the RPR antigen. Okay. Next, besides the RPR antigen, positron negative control is also there in the available in the kit. And the kit also contains a plastic coated RPR white card. And a mechanical rotator is required. Pipettes is required to perform the test. Mechanical rotator, pipettes, and unheated serum, or plasma, or stored serum at 2 to 8 degrees is necessary for performing the procedure. Here, this picture shows two circles. How this positive can be seen here? These positives can be seen as a black spots, okay, black dotted spots. This is nothing but a slide flocculation. Besides sedimenting, these particles are suspended. Antigen antibody reaction particles are suspended with the clearing. Here, negative doesn't show any carbon particles clumping. So how this test is performed? Like the tough rapid slide agglutination, right? Rapid slide agglutination. Here this RPR test is also performed, but here it contains glass or plastic coated slide which contains circles. This circle is for PCA, this circle is for NC, and these circles are used for test serum. This is for one patient, this is for another patient. This is also a rapid test. Sometimes it can be done as a semi-quantitative test also, where we are done as a quantitative test in viral test by doing dilutions of the serum. Here first place a drop of the positive control, and place a drop of negative control, and place a drop of the patient serum, first patient and second patient serum, and add a drop of RPR antigen, and here also for first patient, second patient also place a drop of the RPR antigen. And after mixing thoroughly, place it on the mechanical rotator for 8 minutes or 4 minutes, whatever it is given in the literature of the RPR. Okay, minutes should be rotator based on the time should be based on the literature lo enta time anistara anta time tane manam rotate cheyalanamanta. After rotation observe for agglutination. Here this positive control shows flocculation, carbon dark particles which we'll see with our naked eyes. This is negative, and these two also showing positives. First patient, second patient also. First patient serum, second patient serum also showing positive clumping. This comes under slide flocculation. So positive test means presence of characteristic antigen antibody clumps in the center or the periphery of the test circle indicate the positive RPR test. Negative test means absence of antigen antibody clumps. మనకి నెగిటివ్ కంట్రోల్ లో చూస్తారు కదా ఎలా క్లంప్స్ లేవనేసి అలా ఇండికేటెడ్ బై స్లైట్ రఫ్నెస్ అండ్ నో అగ్రిగేట్స్ అండ్ ఏపీఎస్ లైక్ గ్రే ఇన్ కలర్. అప్లికేషన్స్ ఆర్ మెయిన్ యూస్డ్ యాజ్ స్క్రీనింగ్ టెస్ట్ ఫర్ syphilitic infection, and also used as a screening test for STI, sexually transmitted infection, and also a screening test for pregnant ladies. For antenatal case also, it is this can be used as a screening test. Well, this completes the viral test and RPR test. Thank you.